Hello and welcome back to another MATLAB video. The objective of this video is to show you how to create and run a basic MATLAB program. So, if we open up MATLAB, we'll see a big panel in the middle. This is called the command window. The command window is used to execute commands one by one. I'll show you what I mean. We can create a vector x that goes from 1 to 10. And when I hit enter, this vector is created in our workspace. Or I can create a vector y, which is equal to the square root of x. And when I hit enter, this vector is also created. Or I can even create a plot from these two vectors. And when I hit enter, this figure pops up on the front of my screen. So as we can see, the command window is great if you want to execute commands line by line. But what if you want to execute multiple commands at a time? Well, you can do this by creating a live script. Let's close out of this figure and I'll show you two ways to accomplish this. The first way is to click New and then Live Script. And when you do this, you'll see the Live Editor window pop up on top of the command window. Here, you can type multiple commands without executing them right away. But let's say you already typed a bunch of code in the command window and you want to preserve it for when you create your live script. How do you do that? First, go to your command history and highlight all the commands you want to include in your script. I'll pick the three that we just typed. Then, right-click these commands and hit Create Live Script. You'll notice that just like before, the live editor pops up on top of the command window, but this time it already has the commands that we highlighted. Now, to run this script, I first have to save my file by going to Save, Save As, and giving it a relevant name. Then I'll go to the top here where it says Run All and hit that button. When I do this, all of the commands in the script are executed. We can see in our workspace that two vectors, x and y, were created. And right next to our code, we see the figure that was generated from the plot command. Based on your preference, you can choose whether to have these outputs on the side of your code or in line with your code. These two buttons up here will let you switch between the modes. I'll switch to inline mode so you can see what it looks like. Okay, so the program we wrote so far is pretty simple. I want to go through a few tasks that you may use while writing something more complex. Task number one is adding comments. Comments will help make your code understandable. Typically, they'll describe what your code is doing. You can add a comment by typing a percent sign and then typing your comment like this. Another way to organize your code is to add sections to it. What do I mean by this? Well, when using live scripts in MATLAB, you don't have to run the entire file. You have the option to run your code section by section. Sections will also visually split up your code, making it easier to read and comprehend. To add a section, I'll type 2% signs followed by a space and the name of my section. When I hit enter, we'll see a visual break in the code that separates the section I just created. Let's put a couple of commands here to show you how to run a specific section of code. I'll create a vector x with values 1 to 100, and I'll create another vector y with values 101 to 200. And then I'll plot x, y and make the plot red. Now, instead of hitting run all like I did before, I'll highlight the section I want to run and hit Run Section. We can see the figure that corresponds to the section pop up next to the code we just typed. And if we click on one of these plot commands, we can see that the corresponding figure is highlighted. This is a really useful feature for navigating through your results. Now, we've talked a little bit about formatting our code, but let's talk about some common tasks and constructs used in programming. The first thing that we'll talk about is called indexing. Indexing is used to take a subset of a vector or matrix that we already created. For example, let's look at one of the vectors we created earlier, y. If we open the variable editor, we can see that each element in y takes on a different value. Now, let's say we want to access the fifth element in this vector. We can type y and then in parentheses 5 to get this number. Or if we want the seventh element, we'll type y parentheses 7 close parentheses. Here's some practical examples of tasks that we can do with indexing. We can create a new variable a, which is equal to the fifth element in y. A equals y of 5. Now our workspace shows that a is equal to the same value as y of 5. Or we can change the fifth element of y to be 100. We'll type y of 5 equals 100, enter. And we can see that after executing this command, the fifth value of y has changed. Okay, one last example. Let's say we want to change the first 5 values of y to be the numbers 6 through 10. We can type y of 1 colon 5 equals, and then in square brackets, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. When we hit enter, we can see that the first 5 values of y have changed accordingly. So this covers some of the basics of indexing, and the next thing I want to talk about is something called the if-else statement. You'll use an if-else statement if you want to execute a set of commands only if a certain expression is true. This will be more clear with an example. Let's start by writing a statement that takes in a user input. The line of code I just typed is going to ask for input from the user and convert their answer to a string before proceeding. I'll show you what I mean. If we run this section, it asks us, "Did you learn something?" in the command window. Whatever we type as our answer will be stored in the variable userIn as a string. Now that we have our user input, we'll create an if-else statement that determines what to do based on that user's input. So I'll type it all out and then we can go through it. Starting from the top, if the user types y, then the first expression userIn equals y is true and will display hooray. But if the user does not type y and types n instead, then the second expression is true and will display aw man. Finally, if the user types anything that's not y or n, we'll display, please reread the directions. So let's actually run the program for the three cases. I'll hit run section and answer the question with y for yes. The live editor executes the code in the if section and displays, hooray! I'll run it again, and this time I'll answer the question with n for no. This time, the live editor executes the code in the else if statement and displays, aw man. I'll run it one last time and I'll type something different as my answer. Now, the live editor executes the code in the else section and displays, please reread the directions. Now, one last thing. It's important to note that you can only have one if and one else in each construct, but you can have multiple else if statements. For example, I can add in the following section. Now, if I run this section and respond with Q, the third expression is true, and the live editor displays, why did you type Q? The last construct that we'll talk about is called loops. Specifically, we're going to talk about for loops. Loops are used to repeat a set of commands within your code. So I have a function that'll help us illustrate when this comes in handy. The function is called randomWalk, and I'll give you a visual explanation of how it works. There's a person who's standing a certain number of steps away from his home. Let's just call him LeBron. In the function, LeBron flips a coin, and if it lands heads, he takes one step towards his home. And if it lands tails, he takes one step away from his home. The question is, how many coin flips will it take LeBron to get back to his home? So the input for the function is going to be his starting position, and when we run the function, it automatically simulates his coin flips until he reaches his house. So the output for the function will be the number of coin flips that it took him to get home. For this example, let's say LeBron always starts 3 steps from his house, so the input for the function will be 3. If I hit run, we can see that it took 15 coin flips to get back home. Let's run it a couple more times and see what results we get. Okay, notice how every time the result is different. And at this point, you might be curious, if we ran this 100 times, what would be the average number of coin flips that it would take LeBron to get home? Or maybe you're just wondering what the entire distribution would look like. Instead of rewriting the same command 100 times, we can create a loop, in this case, a for loop. So let me show you what I mean. I'll type it out and then I'll explain what's going on. Alright, so what does all of this mean? Well, our first statement is for I equals 1 colon 100. In this case, I is called an index variable. It's responsible for counting the number of iterations we go through in our loop. So in this case, we'll iterate through the loop 100 times and I will take on values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. all the way up until 100. Everything contained between the for and the end is going to be repeated 100 times. In this case, our function is within our loop, so this is what will be repeated. I'll walk us through a couple of iterations. When we first enter the loop, I is equal to 1. And then we hit our statement, num flips of I is equal to random walk of 3. This is going to create a variable called numFlips. Remember that I is equal to 1, so when we have I in parentheses, we are indexing into the first element of numFlips. We're going to set that value equal to the output of random walk of 3. We reach the end of our loop, so we go back to the top, and this time I is equal to 2. Then we'll hit our function again. This time, it will index into the second element of numFlips and set that value equal to the output of our function. We hit the end of the loop, so we go back to the top, and this time I is equal to 3. Again, we'll execute the random walk function, and this time the result is stored in the third element of the vector. We keep going through this loop until I is equal to 100, and each time we go through it, we add one more element to our vector numFlips. So after 100 iterations, we'll have a vector that has 100 elements in it. So let's go ahead and run this and take a look at the results in the variable editor. Here's our vector with all 100 elements. Now let's do some basic analysis. One thing we might want to do is to check the mean of the data. We'll go back to the command window and use the mean command. Whoa, that seems kind of high. You might be curious to see why it's so high, so let's plot the number of flips that it took on each trial, just as a sanity check. Okay, we can see that some trials took thousands of flips until LeBron got back home, so that's definitely skewing our mean to the higher side. Since we have several large outliers in our distribution, the median may give a better understanding of the data's central tendency. So let's type median of numFlips and see what we get. Okay, that's a little bit closer to what we want. So once we know what kind of analysis we want to do, we can then take those lines and add them to the live editor, and then go ahead and save the program. So that wraps up this video on creating a basic MATLAB program. The examples in this video were pretty simple to illustrate the logic, but these basic principles are applicable for everything from analyzing big data all the way to creating a graphical user interface. And the best way to get familiar with writing MATLAB programs is to practice. If you get stuck, there's plenty of resources on mathworks.com, and you can post your questions in MATLAB Answers as well. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you guys in another video.